I welcome you all to the session of Applied Thermodynamics, and the topic of our today's discussion is the steam nozzle. In fact, in continuation of our last discussion on the analysis of steam nozzle, today we shall see how we can express the mass flow rate of steam when it is passing through the nozzle. It is very important to know at this point of time that we have discussed that when steam is coming out from the flow nozzle, before it enters into the turbine, kinetic energy of steam jet is very important. So, depending on the magnitude of the kinetic energy, the power, rather the work that we will be getting from the turbine depend. So, now question is, if we try to recall, for the flow nozzle we have seen that the area velocity relation can be written like this. I am not going to describe again the significance of individual term, rather we have seen, we have described this in the last class. We have also discussed that depending on the magnitude of flow velocity, I mean if we try to compare that m, which is nothing but Mach number, and which is nothing but c by a. So, depending on the magnitude of Mach number, whether the flow is sonic or subsonic or supersonic, we have different flow configuration. That is, whether the flow is occurring through a gradually decreasing area or it is flowing through a fluidic confinement having equal cross sectional area, or it is flowing through a duct having gradually increasing area. So, today we shall see that mass flow rate of steam is another important quantity, I can say, essentially from the perspective of the kinetic energy of steam at the exit of the nozzle. So, if we try to find out what is mass flow rate of steam, as we have discussed in the last class, that when we are going to have this analysis, we have taken a few assumptions. Which are those? First of all, we have considered that is the flow of a compressible fluid, and the flow is isentropic, that is it is reversible as well as adiabatic. So, there is no heat loss from the system to the surroundings, as well as the fluid friction, both internal as well as external, is absent. So, if we try to find out the expression of mass flow rate through the flow nozzle, again let us define the geometry. And say this is section 2-2 and this is section 1-1, okay. And so this is inlet and this is outlet. So that is section 1-1 refers to the inlet and section 2-2 refers to the outlet. If we do, rather if we apply steady state steady flow equation, I am not going to write, rather I am writing the writing in short form, then we can write h 1 plus c 1 square by 2 plus g z 1 equal to h 2 plus c 2 square by 2 plus g z 2, right. Mind it, this equation we have, rather we are familiar with this equation since our undergraduate time, that is on from thermodynamics, basic thermodynamics course. This equation is obtained essentially from first law of thermodynamics applied to a controlled volume system. So, here since the nozzle is, the outer surface of the flow nozzle is insulated, and by doing so we are ensuring that there is no heat transfer from the system to the surroundings. So, that Q term is 0 and the control volume is not doing any work. So, there is no displacement of the physical displacement of the control volume at a given instant of time. If that is the case, this is the steady flow energy equation in which we have considered both the internal energy as well as the flow work. So, as I told that when steam will be entering into the flow nozzle, to maintain the flow in presence of work, there is a work which is known as flow work. So, the work associated with the flow. So, that to maintain the flow both at inlet and outlet in presence of pressure, we need to know the energy which is associated with this is known as flow energy or flow work. So, this is now, as I told that maybe you know the length of the flow nozzle is very small, length of nozzle is very short. If that is the case, we can trivially say that Z1 is almost equal to Z2. If that is the case, we can write that C2 square minus C1 square by 2 plus H2 minus H1 equal to 0, right. So, we can write, I can write it in a differential form, that is C dC plus dH equal to 0. So, this is what we have seen from previous class. So, this is equation number 1. So, now if we go to the next slide and if we try to write another important equation, that is for any process, right, we can write TdS is equal to dH minus Vdp. I am not going to explain again about this equation because we have seen this is known as second TdS equation, and this is very important equation which is related to entropy, enthalpy and pressure. As I told you that in thermodynamics there are a few quantities which cannot be directly measured. On the contrary, a few properties are there which can be directly measured. So, by measuring those properties which can be directly measured, we also can evaluate the non-measurable or directly non-measurable quantities like entropy and enthalpy. So, this equation, and as the process is isentropic, so this quantity is almost equal to 0. So, this is isentropic process. Okay. Since the process is isentropic, this quantity is 0, and from there we can write dH equal to Vdp. I can write in thermodynamics, we are always try to write in terms of specific volume because specific volume is easily obtainable from this property chart. Here, instead of writing specific volume, I will be writing in terms of density. So, dP by rho. So, this is another important equation. Say this is equation number 2. Okay. Now, if we substitute this equation in equation 1, so let us write substituting equation 2 in equation 1. And we also need to go for some algebraic manipulations. I am not going to do that because this is very simple. In fact, a class 8 or 9 student can do it quickly. So, what I can do, I can write that 1 by rho equal constant power p to the power constant by rho to the power 1 upon k. This k is expansion coefficient, index of expansion. So, as I told you that if I substitute this equation in equation 1, and if we do a few step, we need to do some algebraic steps, and after having those algebraic manipulations we can arrive here. Okay. So, say this is one equation. Now, what we can write if, so say let me write it. Okay. So, dP by rho plus CdC equal to 0. If we compare this equation, that is CdC plus dH equal to 0, what I am doing, I am plugging the, I can plug in the value of dH from equation 2 over here, and eventually I can write this is the equation. So, now from this equation I can write just C2 square minus C1 square by 2 equal to minus P1 to P2 dP by rho, dP by rho. So, this is equation number 3. Okay. So, this is equation number 3 and say this is equation number 4. What we can do? See, now this can be performed provided if we know the value of 1 by rho, whether it may be the function of pressure, and that is what can be seen from equation 4. So, if I plug in the value of 1 upon rho from equation 4 over in equation 3, then I can easily get it C2 square minus C1 square divided by 2 equal to, let me write in a, you know, compact form, that is P1, let me write in a rather in this form, that constant power 1 upon k into P1 power k minus 1 upon k minus P2 power k minus 1 upon k divided by k minus 1 upon k. So, this is the expression. What you can do? See, this is constant power 1 upon k. Constant can be, I mean, now if we look at the schematic depiction, so I mean this equation P V to the power k equal to constant, that is the isentropic process, can be, you know, represented by this equation. So, that is what I have discussed in the last class. So, what I need to know? I need to know the mass flow rate at the exit of the nozzle, and now if I'd like to calculate mass flow rate, if I know the cross sectional area of the section, then if I multiply with rho 2 and also V2 or C2. So, now what I can do? I can express this constant power 1 upon k in terms of P1 by rho 1 k into 1 upon k. So, this is basically constant. So, instead of constant, I am writing P1 upon rho 1 k, is it? So, this into k upon k minus 1 into P1 power k minus 1 upon k minus P2 k minus 1 upon k, right. So, this is basically C2 square minus C1 square upon 2, right. So, this is C2 square minus C1 square upon 2. What we need to know? We need to calculate, because P by, why we are writing this? Because P by rho into k equal to constant. Okay. So, sorry, rho to the power k. So, now what will happen? Here P, I will write not rho into k, I will write rather rho power k. So, here also it appears that I have written rho 1 k, it is not rho 1 k, this is rho 1 power k. It follows from P v k equal to constant. So, P upon rho to the power rho power k is equal to constant. Okay. So, now next step is very important step, that if we do some algebraic manipulation this term, then I can write this fellow in a in different form. That is, if I go over here, that I can write C2 square minus C1 square upon 2 equal k upon k minus 1 into P1 by rho 1 and 1 upon P2 by P1 power k minus 1 upon k. So, this is very simple, you can understand. Just I have taken out P1 power k minus 1 upon k, and by doing some algebraic manipulation, it is possible to write in this form. Okay. So, see, if we now look at the schematic depiction. Now, if we compare, say a fluid is flowing through this fluidic confinement. Now, mass conservation will be satisfied. If I now look at the area of cross, you know, section 1 1 and area of section 2 2, we can easily say that area of section 22 is very, very less than area of section 11. If that is the case, not that is the case, rather that we can see from the schematic depiction, and that is the shape of the nozzle. Okay. Since this area is significantly larger than the area at section 22, we can ignore, rather we can write that C1 will be much, much less than C2. If that is the case, we can write this C2 square by 2 equal to k upon k minus 1 P1 by rho 1 into this quantity. See why we have tried to write in this fashion. See, try to understand, here we are having the ratio of pressure at the outlet of the nozzle to the inlet of the nozzle. So, this is nothing but pressure ratio, that is pressure at the outlet to the nozzle, that this is ratio of pressure to the outlet of the nozzle and that at the inlet of the nozzle. Okay. So, what we can tell, I mean what why we are doing this, this particular ratio has consequence on the mass flow rate that we are going to study today. So, now you can see, I mean if I write this equation, rather I will be writing C2, which is very important. Now, if we draw the schematic again over here, so this is say flow nozzle and this is section 11 and this is section 22. We are interested in calculating the flow rate at section 22. So, mass flow rate m dot at 2 is nothing but rho 2, a 2 and c 2. We know a 2 because that is what is important when a designer is designing the flow nozzle. He or she must be knowing what is a 2. Rho 2 we had to relate because it is not the incompressible flow, that the density will remain constant. So, as the steam flows from section 11 to section 22, at any special location density, if we try to calculate that, I mean we will be having special variation of density. Okay. So, we have to calculate rho 2, and now C 2 already we can have from this expression. So, what is C 2? If we write C 2 equal 2 k by k minus 1 P 1 by rho 1 into 1 minus P 2 by P 1 power k minus 1 upon k. So, let me mark this expression in this form. So, this is what is very important. In fact, to obtain the value of C 2, rather the velocity at the exit of the nozzle, we have done this exercise. So, if we now try to use, rather if we use this expression of C 2, and then we can easily calculate what will be velocity at section 22. Now, as I told you that only the informations of C 2 will not be helpful to calculate m dot 2, as density at section 22 is not equal to density at section 11. So, for that what we need to do, we also need to calculate the density at section 22, because it is the flow of a compressible fluid. So, the density will change with a change in pressure. So, let me briefly reiterate, compressible fluid is a fluid in which there is a significant change in density with a change in pressure, while if the density of the fluid does not change significantly with the change in pressure, that is called incompressible fluid. So, since we are dealing here with the compressible fluid, we must calculate density at section 22 as it differs from the density which it the fluid had at section 1 1. Okay. So now if we go to the next class, next slide, then we can write that P by rho to the power k equal to constant. So I mean I can write P 1 by rho 1 power constant equal to P 2 by rho 2 power constant. So from there we can calculate rho 2 will be equal to rho 1 into P 2 by P 1 power 1 upon k. So if we now use this expression of rho 2 from here, so let me box this equation, rather mark this equation. So what about m 2? Now m dot 2 equal to rho 2 a 2 c 2. Just if we plug in the value of all those quantities, we will be getting, let me write, so a 2 into rho 1 into p 2 by p 1 upon 1 upon k into c 2, that is nothing but twice k by k minus 1 into p 1 by rho 1 into let me into 1 minus p 2 by p 1 power k minus 1 upon k. So this is the expression of the mass flow rate at section 1. So mass flow rate equal to m dot 1 equal to m dot 2. Okay. So this is the from the continuity. So this is obtained from continuity. Okay. So if we have this expression of mass flow rate, just what I'll be doing, I can try to write this expression in a different form, and you can try it. I mean, I can leave this exercise to you all. You can try at your home. But I am writing. I will be trying to express this m dot by a 2 or m dot 2 by a 2. That is nothing but equal to twice k upon k minus 1. Into p 1 rho 1 into p 2 by p 1 to the power 2 upon k minus p 2 upon p 1 power k plus 1 upon k. This entire equation, this entire quantity is under root, and if we mark this equation again, rather I can use different color. So this is the expression of mass flow rate at the exit of the nozzle. So this is, I am writing mass flow rate at the exit of the nozzle. Okay. So this is very important. Why I have tried to write in this form, you can understand again, as I have discussed few minutes back, we have been able to express this quantity in terms of the pressure ratio P 2 by P 1. Definitely this pressure ratio is an important ratio in the context of the analysis of flow through a nozzle, and perhaps we are going to discuss the significance of this pressure ratio on the flow phenomenon through a nozzle. K is constant, rho 1 p 1, that you know. So I mean our objective should be, as I told you, our objective should be to increase the mass flow rate. If I can, then perhaps our objective should be to increase mass flow rate in a way it indicates that if A 2 is remaining fixed, then perhaps you are trying to increase the velocity upstream at the exit of the nozzle, right? If why? Because if we can increase the velocity upstream at the exit of the nozzle, kinetic energy will increase. if we can increase the kinetic energy of steam before it strikes the turbine blades, we can expect the work output from the turbine will be higher. Now, try to understand this, to if we like to increase this quantity, K is fixed, right? It depends on the, you know, kind of I will discuss, because though it is not you know right, though it is not included in the syllabus, but say for K is constant. Also, at the given, rather at the inlet of the nozzle, we know the quality of steam, so pressure and density is constant. So you can understand, if K is constant, P1 is constant, and also rho1 is constant, then this quantity m dot by A2 is a function of the pressure ratio P2 by P1, right. So, which is very important to know at this point, that K is really, K is constant. In fact, that is what I was talking about in the last class, that this is index, you know index of, you know, expansion coefficient, okay. So, this is index for the expansion. Now, then in that case, for a given thermodynamic state at the inlet of the nozzle, P1 and rho1 is also constant. So, what we can say, that mass flow rate of at the exit of the nozzle can be increased by tuning the pressure ratio, right. So, that is what is very important. So, now if we write that mass flow rate m dot 2 by A2 is function of P2 by P1 as K P1 and rho1 are constant. Right. If we now, why? So, if we try to find out a particular flow ratio, particular pressure ratio for which flow rate through the nozzle will be maximum. So, say if we try to find out that R equal to P2 by P1, that is pressure ratio. So, the critical pressure ratio for which the quantity m dot 2 by A2 will be maximum. So, we need to find out the critical pressure ratio, that is a pressure ratio for which the quantity m dot A, m dot 2 by A2 will be maximum, and that critical pressure ratio equal to known as P2 by P1 critical equal to 2 upon k plus 1 to the power k by k minus 1. It is very simple, you know, that you just take that quantity d of this, of that, if you express this quantity in terms of r, that is p2 by p1 equal to r. So, d of this quantity by dr, if you make it 0, you will be getting r critical, okay. So, now this is very important at this point of time. Let me discuss about a few issues. So, what do we mean by critical pressure ratio? Let me tell you, though it is not included in this course, but still I am telling you, since I have discussed this part in detail. So, critical pressure ratio, when there is a compressible fluid flow through a convergent nozzle. So, let me write. So, when there is, or I can write, a flow of a compressible fluid through a fluidic channel, okay, having slowly decreasing area. area, right. The ratio of exit pressure to the inlet pressure, the ratio of exit pressure to inlet pressure for which, right, mass flow rate, the mass flow rate is maximum is called as the critical pressure ratio. Okay. So, this is called as critical pressure ratio. So, try to understand, when there is a flow of a compressible fluid through a fluidic confinement which is having slowly decreasing area, that is of convergent type, the ratio of exit pressure to the inlet pressure for which the mass flow rate at the exit of the nozzle will be maximum is known as the critical pressure ratio. Okay. So, now you know the critical pressure ratio, you know, it is, I am not going to discuss all those parts, because when there is a critical pressure ratio, there the minimum, I mean also the pressure at which the area is minimum and discharge is maximum, right, is also termed as critical pressure ratio. Also the pressure ratio for which the discharge area is minimum and discharge per unit area is maximum is known as critical pressure ratio. Okay. So, this is very important. Now, let me discuss about that. We have seen that in the last class, we have been able to establish the expression relating area and the velocity, that is in terms of Mach number. Today, we have derived the expression of critical, I mean mass flow rate. From there, we have tried to understand what do we mean by critical pressure ratio. To be precise, we have also discussed about the significance of critical pressure ratio. So, a nozzle is said to be, a nozzle is said to have the critical pressure ratio when the flow rate at the exit of the nozzle is maximum. Okay. So, now I will be discussing about one important term, that is called nozzle efficiency, right. See, we have discussed about this particular component, which is an essential component for the smooth operation of the power plant. As we have discussed many times, that steam is not allowed to directly go into the turbine after it leaves steam or generator or boiler. It should be allowed to pass through the flow nozzle, essentially to increase the kinetic energy. From the discussion of reaction turbine and impact, you know, impulse turbine, we have seen that steam is allowed to pass through different rows of nozzles, and one row of nozzle and one row of, you know, moving blades, these two rows constitute together to form a stage. So, we have seen that if there are multi-stage, you know, in a multi, for the multi-stage turbine, so we will be having multi rows of flow nozzles. So, that means, when steam is passing through the flow nozzle, our essential objective is to increase the kinetic energy of steam before it enters into the turbine. So, we can increase the kinetic energy of steam at the cost of the drop in the enthalpy. So, you try to understand, this H is nothing but U plus PV, right. So, this is internal energy. What do you mean by that? I mean, as I told you in the last class, the temperature is a good representative measure of the internal energy. In addition to this, because it is a flow process, we will be having potential energy as well as the kinetic energy. So, this fellow will take care of the potential energy, kinetic energy as well as the temperature at that particular, you know, section. While this is responsible, this is known as flow energy or flow work, that is when there is a flow through any fluidic confinement, to maintain the flow in presence of pressure, we need to invest energy, and that is nothing but the flow energy. So, these two terms together constitute one important property in thermodynamics, that is enthalpy. So now, when there is a, you know, in a nozzle, in a flow nozzle, we have seen that essentially we are playing with pressure and velocity. So at the cost of the reduction in pressure, we are increasing velocity. So you know that when you are trying to have reduction in pressure and at the cost of that pressure reduction, we are trying to achieve higher velocity, essentially you are playing with enthalpy. So when there is a flow through a steam nozzle, enthalpy will change. If we try to look at the change in enthalpy, whether entire process, entire analysis that we have carried out till now is based on an important assumption, is that the flow is isentropic, that is reversible adiabatic. But in reality, it is very difficult to have any process to be reversible. You have studied in classical thermodynamics that attaining a reversible process is very, very difficult. That is, you know, it would be very difficult. So we can say the process is reversible essentially to have the closed form expression, if we try to have the analysis. But in reality, achieving such a process, that is reversible process, is really difficult. Now, so you can see that enthalpy will definitely drop from as steam passes through inlet to the outlet, but in the analysis, since we have taken that important assumptions that the flow is isentropic flow, so we can assume that the actual drop of enthalpy will be definitely different than the ideal drop in enthalpy. So we can do some mathematical calculation. We can try to find out what will be the isentropic enthalpy drop. So you know that you have studied Mollier diagram, that is very important diagram that help us to obtain different thermodynamic properties. Okay, the idea is that enthalpy which will drop as the steam passes through the nozzle between two sections, that is 1-1 and 2-2, the actual enthalpy drop is not equal to the ideal enthalpy drop. So accounting for that aspect, we can define what is known as nozzle efficiency. So nozzle efficiency, as I told you, that when steam is flowing through the nozzle, we will be having internal friction. No fluid is inviscid, so viscosity will be there, and if the fluid is having finite viscosity, we really cannot ignore the internal friction. Also, steam is passing or through the steam is moving through a fluidic confinement that is bounded by solid surface. So when the steam is passing over the solid surface, we also cannot trivially ignore the external friction. So accounting for these two different sources of friction, that is internal friction and external friction, the process will be highly reversible. And in that case, though we can ensure that the external surface of the nozzle will be insulated, so we can really minimize the heat loss, but we cannot make it completely zero. So still there will be some amount of heat transfer from the nozzle to the external ambience, but we can minimize that. But again, we really cannot ignore the frictional losses when steam is passing through the flow nozzle. So we can define, if we try to go through the next slide and if we try to draw the HS diagram. So this is known as Mollier diagram. Okay. So you know that Mollier diagram. So the constant pressure line, as you can see, this constant, so this is, say this is P condenser, or P, I can say this is P2 and this is P1. Say this is at the inlet to the nozzle and this is at the exit of the nozzle. Okay. So the pressure lines diverge as they are HS diagram. So this is known as Mollier chart. So now say we are having so this is the one, so this is the case, and say let me remove this part. So if we now we are having, say this is one and this is two, okay, and if I use different color, say this is red color, the actual process will be like this. So this is 2 prime. Okay. So now try to understand this is the actual enthalpy drop, that is h1 minus h2 prime, right. If we ignore the elevation of the flow nozzle, so c2 prime square minus c1 square by 2, right, from the steady flow energy equation. While, so this is the actual so this quantity is h1 minus h2 equal to c2 square minus c1 square by 2, and this is basically this quantity is h2 prime minus h2, right. So, you can see that we are thinking that the enthalpy drop will be from 1 to 2, that is ideal enthalpy drop, but actual drop will be from 1 to 2 prime, that is slightly less than the actual one, ideal one. So, we can define the nozzle efficiency, that is nothing but nozzle efficiency, and that is known as ratio of, it is defined as the ratio of heat drop to that due to isentropic expansion. Right. So, this is the ratio. Can't we say in another way, let me write it. So, we can say this is, it is the ratio of actual gain in another way, it is the ratio of actual gain in kinetic energy to that of isentropic expansion. Isentropic expansion. Okay. So, basically we are expecting that the kinetic energy increment will be c2 square minus c1 square by 2, but that is not the case, rather we are having actual gain in kinetic energy to that of the isentropic expansion, and this is known as nozzle efficiency. Mathematically it can be expressed in terms of, let me write it. So, eta nozzle equal to h1 minus h2 prime divided by h1 minus h2. Right. In other way, we can write this equal to C2 prime square minus C1 square divided by C2 square minus C1 square. Okay. If I have C1 is very, very small as compared to C2 or C2 prime, then we can write this expression, equal to, I can write that is C2 prime square by C2 square. So, this is as good as this, right. So, now if we try to summarize today's discussion, what we have discussed today, that we have tried to know the mass flow rate of steam at the exit of the nozzle, which is very important because our objective should be to design the nozzle in such a way that the mass flow rate of steam per unit area at the exit should be maximum. For that, how we can design? After establishing this expression, we have found that this quantity m dot 2 by a 2 is a function of p 2 by p 1. So, the ratio of pressure at the exit of the nozzle to the inlet of the nozzle, which plays an important role to dictate the maximum mass flow rate. And we have also tried to find out the critical pressure ratio for which mass flow rate will be maximum. And since it is not included in this course, I did not discuss that when the nozzle is said to be choked. So, when the nozzle is operating at the critical pressure ratio, if we try to reduce pressure at the exit further, there will not be any increment in mass flow rate through the nozzle, and when the nozzle is said to be choked. So, when the nozzle is operating at a critical pressure ratio, further reduction in pressure at the exit will not allow the mass flow rate to increase. So, the information at the exit that reduction in pressure will not be sensed at the inlet, so that additional amount of flow rate that we are looking for will not be achieved in practice, and the nozzle is said to be choked. And after that, we have tried to understand what do we mean by nozzle efficiency, because whenever we are talking about any mechanical device, mechanical component, we need to know its efficiency. So, and from this HS diagram, we have found that though our analysis is based on the assumptions that it is frictionless adiabatic flow, but still in reality we cannot ignore the fluid friction, and on accounting for the fluid friction, the efficiency can be defined even when there is a flow through a nozzle. And we have tried to quantify the efficiency of nozzle mathematically, and we have seen that it can be written in terms of the C2 prime square by C2 square, that I mean the actual gain in kinetic energy, the ratio of actual gain in kinetic energy that to that of the isentropic expansion. So, with this I stop here today, and we shall continue our discussion in the next class. Thank you.